So I'd like to bring out our first speaker, prolific package author. He's snuck some of his own code into the framework. You may have seen this thing called Ignition. You may be using Flare in your production app. So I'd like to welcome to the stage to open the conference, Freek van der Herten.
Hi, good morning, everybody. I'm glad to be here. My jet lag's a little bit processed, hopefully. So let's get it on. I'm Freek van der Herten. I'm a partner and a developer at a company called Spacy. I'm Freek Meurze on Twitter. There's a few sites that I run. Freek.dev is my blog. I talk about PHP and Laravel development there. This year, I launched a SaaS called Flare. It's an exception tracker for Laravel applications. I built it together with Marcel and our teams. And I also run Odir, which is an uptime monitoring SaaS. Before heading into the talk, I want to give some few numbers about the open source work that Spacy does. We currently have more than 250 packages registered on Packagist. They've been downloaded now for more than 50 million times, and they are being downloaded for about 3 million times a month, which is quite nice, considering that we've done this with a very small team. You can find a big list of everything that we've done on our company website. I'm pretty sure there's something there for your next project. So what I'm going to talk about here is I'm going to walk you to the Flare code base. And an alternative title for this talk could be a way to structure a large Laravel application. Because Flare, it is a pretty big application. And I'd like to emphasize that this is not a sales talk. I'm not here to sell you a subscription or anything. I want to talk about techniques that we used in our project to make it more manageable that could be of use in your projects as well. And everything I'm going to say is opinionated, so make up your own mind if this is applicable to your projects or not. It's mostly focused at large applications, so don't do these kind of techniques with smaller applications. So in this talk, I'm going to do a short walkthrough of the UI, so you know a little bit what Flare is about. Then we'll talk a little bit about domains. And after that, we'll give an introduction in how we used Inertia, React, and TypeScript in this application. So with that out of the way, let's take a look at Flare itself, so you can get a little bit of feel of what it is about. So this is the homepage. And if I go into the application, I have a list of projects here. And those projects, they correspond probably with an application that sends exceptions. If I head into one of the projects, I can see all of the errors here. If I click on an error, I can see information about the latest occurrence of that. And you might be familiar with the layout. The layout is just the same as the Ignition error page in Laravel. Of course, we have some JavaScript interactions going on. I can search some errors here. Oh, my caps lock is on. I can jump to some projects here. I also have like accountings. Yeah, and my icons aren't loading because I think it uses it's because of the Wi-Fi down, but that doesn't really matter. Everything is also theme-based, so we have settings for a theme, we have a plan, we have invoices, we have members here, and so on. So that is a little bit what we are going to talk about. Let's head back to the slides. So using domains, this is a technique that we used in the Flare codebase. So a domain is a term taken from domain design development, and it means a sphere of knowledge or a sphere of functionality. And it's a way of grouping your code around functionalities. And yeah, like I said, this is applicable for larger projects. So this is what you're familiar to with like smaller projects. You have an app directory, and you have like a models directory, mails, events, all the directories you've come to expect. And all the classes are just organized by their type. But if you refactor to domains, then you're going to structure it a little bit different. you're going to not have all those folders in your application directory, but instead you'll have a domain directory. And inside that domain directory, you'll have a subdirectory for each big part of your application. So let's take a look at the Flare code base to see how we use it there. So let me make this a little bit bigger for you. So we have, this is the Flare code base. It's a Laravel project. And if I open the app directory, you don't see like a models directory or the other directories you might be familiar with. But if I open up domain, then you see here the big chunks that Flare consists of. And the benefit of this is if I want to work on like the project functionality, then I just open up that subdirectory. And this is like a mini Laravel application on its own. You have the models for this part here. You have the jobs for this part here. And if we wouldn't have this structure, these folders would become very, very big. When I work on the project functionality, I don't want to see the rest. I just want to see what is relevant for me when working on this part of the functionality. And you might think, hey, doesn't Laravel expect those classes to be in those default directories? And the answer is no. Laravel just doesn't care where those things are stored. If you have like a test suite in your application and you move to this kind of structure, then you'll see that you'll probably have no errors at all. I'd like to show you how you can get started with this if you have a large application. So I have the ODIR code base here as well. And recently we switched it to using domain organization as well. So I have all the big chunks that that ODIR consists of. And I have another branch here called no domains. And this is how the code looked earlier. So here all of these folders are in the application directory. And you can see that I have like a lot of models here. And all those classes are very long. So how do we get started with like a domain organization here? Now, one of the smaller domains in ODIR is the block domain. We have a block running on there, and it uses some functionality here. Let's refactor this a little bit. So I have the post model, and I want to get started with domains. So I have to move this class to a different namespace. And PHP Storm actually has a lot of helpful refactoring methods that make this very easy. You can just perform a move refactor. And here you can edit the namespace, and it just, I'm going to move this into another namespace, domain block models. And PHP Storm will just adjust the namespace. It will also move it to the correct directory. And if I do git status, then you'll see that it will have updated all of the references to that class as well. So it's pretty easy to just move one class. You can also move an entire namespace at once. I know that we have in our services directory, we have a Twitter subdirectory. And I know that this Twitter functionality is only used for the blog. We tweet out the links of every blog post that was published. So it makes sense to have this code in the blog domain as well. Let's do that now. So if I want to move an entire namespace, I just click on the namespace, and I perform a move refactor here. And I just type in the new namespace, and it isn't responsive now. Let me try that again. Move. I think I've hit a PHP Storm bug. And it isn't good because I'm very limited on time. Let me just quit PHP Storm and just do that again. Sorry for the snag. So let's open it up again. I guess all of you have troubles with PHP Storm at one go. It's an excellent program, but if you head up on stage, then you sometimes have troubles. So let's see if this gets better. Let's load it again. And go back to that Twitter folder here. Twitter, I'm going to do the move refactor again and see if I can type here. And now I can type here, so problem solved. Thanks, major achievement. So let's move this into domains block, and I'm going to use like the support subdirectory, which I tend to like more nowadays. And if I confirm this, both of these classes, the namespace will be updated and they will be moved to here. Did I make a typo? Sorry? I used domains. Okay. Let's fix that immediately. So I'm going to move that domains namespace again. It's moving to domain, refactor it. And now it's now it's here. And now I have a block domain. And basically, to get started with domain organization, just go through every class in your application and perform this move refactoring. People sometimes ask, how do you know which domains there are? I'm certain that there is a lot of literature on this, but at our company, it's just mostly a gut feeling. We don't start with the structure by default. It's only when the application becomes a little bit big, and then we already know what the big concepts of our application are. So again, this is a method to make your project a little bit more manageable when it becomes bigger. Good. Let me open the Flare application again. And let's move into the next section. So now we're going to talk about some front-end stuff. And let's see how am I on time. And it's okay. This is a quote by my colleague Sebastian, who does a lot of JavaScript programming and front-end programming in general in our company. And he recently wrote a blog post on how much JavaScript you really need. And Seb said that, I strongly believe that JavaScript is a requirement for excellent user experiences. Not good experiences, but excellent experiences. You can create a good UI with just Blade and no JavaScript at all. But if you have something complex, you probably want to have some JavaScript interactions as well to make it truly excellent. There's a lot of things that can be discussed about that statement. I simply don't have the time to do that now. Hit me up afterwards if you want to talk about this a little bit more. And for Flare, we used a library called Inertia. It's built by Jonathan Ranning. And very shortly said, Inertia allows you to replace Blade by a front-end framework like React or Vue or whatever. So all of your views are now written in React. And what is the big problem that Inertia solves for us? It makes the communication between the server and the client seamless. So it takes care of the serialization of all of your data. And it makes it, and it does that in a way that you don't have to adjust your main application too much. You don't have to build like a separate API that feeds your front end. You can just use a regular Laravel application for this. And as a bonus, there will be no full page refreshes, which I will demonstrate in a second. So one of the biggest changes you'll have to do in your application is to convert this, where you use a Blade view, to this. So you're not using the view helper anymore, but instead you're going to use Inertia render, and you're going to give it a component name, like a view name, and you're going to give it the data that the front end needs. So let me show you how it works. So I'm going to head into the browser, and we're going to use this invoice screen. So I know this will probably be a little bit small, but I'll tell you what is going on. So the first time I load up a page, let me move this a little bit to the top, all resources are being loaded, and some fail because I don't have an internet connection. And if I go to another screen, let me make this empty, then only the server-side endpoint is getting hit to fetch the data, and the JavaScript needed for this page is getting loaded. If I switch again, then only the server endpoint is getting hit, but no JavaScript is loaded, no CSS is being loaded, because that's all in memory. So this makes it very snappy. Now let's see how data is transferred to these screens. And there are actually this method, let's go to the controller. So it's the invoices controller. Yeah, it's this one. So this is the controller that feeds that invoices view. And you can see here we use inertia render and we pass it team invoices and show archive link. Now the first time I'm going to load up the page, then what inertia will do is it will dump all of that data serialized on the HTML page. So when the JavaScript loads, it doesn't need to make an extra HTTP call to get the data, because it's already written on the page. But the second time you hit the route, so let's now just do that. I'm going to hit the invoices again. Let's see what I'm going to do that again to just have it only that response. So here we have that invoices response here. And you see now that the response isn't an HTTP response, but it is a JSON response. So you can see here in the properties that we have like an invoices key, we have that team key, we have that show archive link here. So inertia render did that all behind the screens for us. So on an initial page load, it will write it into the HTML page. But on a second visit, if you already loaded up and you revisit the page, this information will be serialized. And this is how inertia makes that communication seamless for you. Now let's head into the React component that renders that invoices page. So I'm going to go to invoices. .tsx, and if you're not familiar with React, that's no problem. I don't want to delve into details, but just the higher concept. So in React, each component is just a function, and it gets an object that has like the keys I specified as a parameter. So here we have that team invoices show archive link. It corresponds to what I've sent it here. And I'd like to give you a quick course on TypeScript here. So you can see here that we typed the whole of this as props. And at the code a little bit above, we defined that type props and we said like a theme is a certain type, invoices is an array of invoices, and show archive link is a Boolean. Now, if I head into that invoice definition, you can see that it has some certain properties. It has an ID, total, create links, created at, and a links key that has a download key inside of it. Now, on the server side, let's go back to invoices detail controller. I can open up that invoice resource. And a resource is a class in Laravel, like you're familiar with. It converts a model or another kind of class to an array response that can be serialized to get it to the front end. So here we have the same properties. So we have like a resource with the properties, and we have like a type definition with this properties. And what benefits does doing this bring to the table? Well, if I go to a piece of code where an invoice is used, like for instance here. Here's an invoice used. If I hit a point, then PHP Storm can just auto-complete it for me. And this is nice to work with your JavaScript code, that you know which properties are in there. And also, if I type something that doesn't exist there, PHP Storm will just notify me of that. And this is very handy when creating interfaces like that. You don't have this when you're creating blade views. You're just hoping that all the properties are on the objects you have in your blade view. But in TypeScript and React, you actually know which pieces of data you have there. Time is still good. Let's talk a little bit about how we handle authorization, how we and how we transfer like authorization checks to the client. So if I go to the members page, I have this little button here called Invite Team Member, and this button is only displayed if a user is an administrator or an owner of that team, because we don't want like everybody to invite other users. Only owners can do that. Now let's take a look at where this this code is used. So it's used, I think, in members index.tsx. Yeah, here it is. And here we have that function can administer team, and if it can administer it, we will render that invite team members thing. So let's break it down how all of this works. So on the server side, we have a team policy. So it's just a regular Laravel policy. And we have some checks on here, and one of them is administer. And it will return true if the user is an admin of of an owner of that team. We use a few constants here. Let's see why they are being used. So I'm going to head to the team resource, and it's this one. And you can see here that when we send a team from the backend to the frontend, we're going to serialize it like this. We're going to give it a few properties, and we'll also give it like a can array. And in that can array, we'll perform all of the authorization checks. So we have here the administer one, if the current user can administer this resource, which is the team. This will be either true or false depending on the current user. And we use those constants here just to get a little auto-completion on it, like which policy checks are there. Now on the client side, we have that type also defined. So I'm going to find the type team here, and here you can see that we've also typed it, that we've typed all the attributes, and we've also have like that can object here that contains all of the authorization checks. Okay, let's go back to the code where this is used. So I have that can administer theme thing. And let's delve into the details of that that can function. And I'm going to copy the usage of this so we can understand it better. So this is the can method itself. Let me paste how we use it so I can explain it. Now, with all the TypeScript in here, it can be hard to read if you're not familiar with TypeScript at all. So let me strip out all of the TypeScript things so we can just see like the naked function. So it is, in fact, quite a simple function. So we pass it what we call an authorizable, which is the team, and we're going to check the can property of it for the ability, so administer, that we gave it. So this will return true or false. So it's pretty easy. And now you know how we make it flow from the backend to the frontend. It's just performing all the policy checks and put them in a property that we call can. Now, let me explain the TypeScript checks that we add to this, because this is like really a thing of beauty. It's been coded up by my colleague Sebastian. Let me break it down for you. So what are we going to do here is we're going to define we're going to use a certain type in this definition. We use the authorizable type, and we'll alias it to T, which is like a common thing to do when you're using JavaScript. And the authorizable type is something we defined here. An authorizable is any object that has a can property, which has strings in it for keys and booleans as it as values. So, and here we say like the authorizable, the second parameter, is of type T, is an authorizable. So we say that team is an authorizable, it has that can array. And then with ability, we also had some TypeScript check here. So we say, like, ability should be a string first and foremost, and it should also be one of the keys that is in the can property of the authorizable. So this is something you can't do with PHP type hints. This is actually very powerful. And let's see what this brings to the table when we use it. So I have here administer, it's just a regular string. But let's see what happens if I just type up junk here. Then PHP Storm can actually warn me, hey, this check isn't available on the front end. And it can even say to me, hey, there's only, let me make it a little bit bigger. There's only administer, delete, leave, or handle financial details for the authorizable you gave it here. So it's the suggestion that it makes here depends on what kind of object you give here, which is very, very powerful. Oh, and if I just put administer back again, if I use like a wrong object here, maybe team invitations, which I know isn't an authorizable, that doesn't have a can property, then TypeScript will actually say to me, hey, the property can is missing on this type. So you get a lot of protection from the type system of giving or of doing things wrong. When you refactor some of the JavaScript code, then TypeScript, if you have no type errors at all, then there is a high chance that your code will just run. So it's a pretty nice thing. Let's head back to the slides. So I'm going to close off now, and we have 3 minutes. It's perfect timing, really. So I've talked about using domains. My colleague Brent, who pushed this practice in our company, has written a good blog post about this. That's the first link. I've also written a few blog posts about some techniques that we used in this code base as well, namely the actions. I don't have time to talk about it now, but if you want some more tricks, just read those blog posts. And we also talked about inertia.js. Just read the documentation at inertia.js.com if you want to know more about it. If you want to know more about TypeScript, head over to that page. And I know this talk was a little bit fast, but I've also written a blog post on how we handle front-end authorization with inertia and TypeScript. Just read that one if some things were unclear to you. And with that, that's everything I want to say. I'll upload the slides in a bit. Check out the open source section at my company website. Pretty sure that there's something there of use to you. And yeah, that's all I have for you. Thank you.
So you said in your talk that your packages have been downloaded, or the Sparsi packages have been downloaded about 50 million times.
Yeah.
Are your postcards per download or per package?
There's really no limit on how many postcards that you can send to us. Send as much as you can.
He's 12.
Oh, wow. Thanks, man. I appreciate it. Thanks.
Thanks, bye, Frank. Bye.